Good morning, all. Thank you, Jane, and thank you for inviting me to this workshop. As Jane said, my name is Carole Vignals. I'm a medical resident in infectious disease in Bordeaux. And this year, I've done my master's degree in epidemiology in Bordeaux, and I have done a work in collaboration, in close collaboration with Jane and Jane Effernan and David Dick from York University. So my talk today will be in two parts. One major part in which I will introduce the work we have done about modeling impact of waning immunity in the French context and trying to see if barrier gesture, and going to define barrier gesture, will be relaxed once. And the second part, at the end, I will just show you some slides about some explorations we have been doing recently, in particular about detection rates in this model. So briefly, I will just introduce some context for France. In France, actually, we have about 74% of the French population that has been fully vaccinated. As you all know, there is some evidence that maybe immunity confirmed by infection or by vaccination may wane. And this is something we want implement in our model. And this is what we have done here using a model that have been already developed before. I will tell you about that just after. In France, many non-pharmaceutical interventions have been implemented since the beginning of the epidemic. But since this summer 2021, many of these restrictions have been removed and everything is open. Schools, bars, restaurants, everything is open. People can work at work. But still, one thing is still recommended is barrier gestures. Those gestures are simply wearing a mask when you are in closed places and washing hands regularly, for example. One another thing that have been implemented since August 2021 is sanitary passports. And this passport is needed to go to bars and restaurants, and you need to be vaccinated or you need to have a negative test to go to these places. So the aim of our study, we did this study this last summer. So the aim was to estimate the consequences of the barrier gesture relaxation on the evolution of the epidemic in France, taking into account vaccination, but also variants of concern. And during this period, in particular, the Delta variant, and also taking into account that immunity wanes. So the model we use is a model that has already been developed by Childs and collaborators, initially to model pertussis and then to COVID-19. This model is an SEIR age structured compartmental model, so divided in 16 age classes. So I'm going to present the model each compartment because it's a little bit more complicated than a simple SEIR model. So you have the S compartment here. You have four levels of susceptibility. S1 compartment corresponds to a fully susceptible individual. Then you have S2 and S3 compartments that correspond respectively to people that have low or moderate immunity against SARS-CoV-2. And people in S4 compartment correspond to people fully immune that are no longer susceptible to infection. When people from S compartment get infected, then move to the E compartment. And after several days, they move to I compartment. So E compartment, as you know, is infected but not yet infectious. And I compartment are infected and infectious. You can see that there are three levels of infectious compartment depending on disease severity. So I2 compartment correspond to mild infections, so which are asymptomatic infections. I3 compartment correspond to moderate infections, which are symptomatic but not severe. And I4 are severe infections, which mean here infections that will require at least a medical consultation. When after several days, people infected will recover and they will move to S compartments that correspond to their disease severity. So people in I2 and I3 will move respectively in S2 and S3 compartments, and people in I4 will move in S4. You can see here that there is this is not implemented yet. Is not implemented. On this model, we add a vaccinated compartment, so vaccinated with two doses. So there is here, this first line here is for vaccination with one dose from S compartment. And 4 weeks after, people vaccinated once get automatically their second dose and move into one of the V2 compartments. You can see here that S and V compartments have blue shades, different blue shades that correspond to their immunity level. So people in S4 have the same immunity level than people vaccinated twice, so all people in V2 compartments, but also people that have received one dose from S3 or people that have received one dose from S4. And all of these people are no longer susceptible to infection. You can also see that people in S3 have the same level of immunity than people vaccinated once from S2, and people in S2 have the same level of immunity than people vaccinated once from S1 compartment. You can also notice that people in S3 cannot do anymore a severe infection. They have an immunity. We assume that they have an immunity that protects against severe infections. Then you can see that waning immunity is implemented. So people in V and S compartment can wane their immunity. It's represented by the black arrows. So for example, people from S4 can wane into S3, as well as people vaccinated twice, or these people that can wane in S3 and from S3 in S2 and then S1. We have done a few analyses with different waning rate assumption, but in the main analysis, and maybe we can discuss that, but because maybe with the knowledge we have, we may think that this assumption is optimistic, but in the main analysis, we assume that it takes 3 years to go from S4 to S3, 3 years to go from S3 to S2, and also 3 years to go from S2 to S1. So 9 years to go from S4 to S1 in the main analysis. All of the movements between compartments are governed by these parameters. And I'm going to present some of these parameters, but not all because it would be too long. So we are going to focus on some of them. So for example, as I said, there is a decreased susceptibility for people of higher immunity level. So people in S2 and S3, whereas S4 are no longer susceptible to infection. The beta is the infectivity depending on infectious severity, and this beta is set to reproduce a basic reproductive number to 2.9, which is what has been estimated for France initially from Salge et al. Work. Another parameter which is important to introduce is the proportion of people infected from S that are going to high infection and to mild, moderate, or severe. So for this parameter, we assume that people that have no comorbidity to do a severe COVID-19 will do a mild infection. People that have one comorbidity at risk will do a moderate infection. And people that have at least two comorbidities at risk will do a severe infection. This proportion of comorbidity by age are informed by Clark et al. Work, which have estimated this proportion for many countries, but as well for France. About vaccination parameter. So in the main analysis, we assume that vaccine efficacy against infections after two doses is 80%. Vaccine efficacy against infections and against severe cases after one dose is assumed to be 50% and 17% in the main analysis. You can see that we have done a sensitivity analysis with higher vaccine efficacies. finally, the last parameter, which is important, but we have already discussed a little bit about that before, is the waning rate of immunity. And as I said, in the main analysis, we assume that it takes 3 years to go from one immunity level to a lower immunity level. And we have done two sensitivity analyses, one in which we assume it takes 1 year to go from one level to one lower immunity level. So it takes 3 years to go from S4 to S1. And one another analysis without vaccine, without waning immunity, Vaccination is implemented in the model, and vaccination rates are informed by VACCI database, which is a vaccination surveillance database for France. Vaccination starts in January 2020, and first it's the elderly that is eligible, and then successive wider age class are eligible to vaccination. You can see that from June, children are eligible in the model. At the end of vaccine rollout, at the end of October 2021, in this model, we have vaccinated at least by one dose, 73% of the population. We assume that there is vaccine hesitancy, which is a reality. And in this model, we assume that we assume this proportion of vaccine hesitancy, which means that these people won't be vaccinated. We also implemented the variants of concern, so alpha and delta. The proportion of variants among all infections is informed in the past by CIDEP. And then we have done some prediction, in particular for Delta. And for Delta, we used the information from ECDC. We assume that Alpha is half more transmissible and Delta is 97 more transmissible compared to the historical strain respectively. Our contact rates are informed by contact matrices. These contact matrices have been estimated for France in particularly thanks to Prem et al. Work. In these contact matrices are divided in four different places, so at home, work, school, or other contacts. And we have modified these contact matrices to take into account the different mitigation periods. So for example, we took into account lockdowns, curfews, closing schools, bars and restaurants, and work from home, because these different measures have been implemented over time, and we have modified and decreased contact rates given the moment and the time for which these measures have been applied in France. Then how do we calibrate? Did we calibrate our model? So we fit our model to incidence data, so daily reported COVID-19 cases informed by CIDEP, which is another surveillance database for France. We calibrated from May 2020 to July 2021, and we assume that all reported COVID-19 cases correspond to 3/5 of moderate infections and all severe infections. And we will discuss about these assumptions in the second part of this talk. The only parameter that is fit to data is named K-value. This value lies between 0 and 1. And correspond to a compliance index to barrier gestures. So this K value reflects the application by the population of barrier gestures. It also reflects other things that we don't take into account, for example, detection rates, for example. And this K value will scale contact rates, the contact rates that we have obtained from the modified contact matrices. You have here the plot of the K value estimated among the calibration period. As I said, our aim is to estimate the impact of a barrier gesture relaxation in France. So to simulate this relaxation, we use this K value. And first we simulate a no relaxation scenario in which from July 2021, the K values will stay equal to last year estimation. And we simulate different relaxation scenarios starting from either August, September, October, November, or December. in which we elevate k-value to either 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, or 1. When k-value is equal to 1, it means that there is no barrier gesture, and it corresponds to pre-pandemic contact rates. I forgot to tell you that, but I said in the introduction, but from the beginning of summer for France in 2021, there is no more any restrictions, so no curfew, no lockdown, anything. So there is only the barrier gestures that decrease contact rates. So if we elevate the k-value to 1, it means that it's pre-pandemic contacts. Then we focus on the predicted peak of severe infections following each relaxation scenario. And also we deduced using the mean ratio between the mean ratio in the past between ICU hospitalization and severe infections from the model. We deduced the peak of ICU hospitalization predicted following each relaxation scenario. Okay, now let's move to the results. So just for the calibration plot, you have here in the y-axis incidence in a logarithmic scale and the time here. So you have represented in red the incidence, the smooth incidence data, and in black, the infections from the model. The black line corresponds to severe infections. The dotted line corresponds to moderate and severe infections, and the dashed line to all infections. So we expect that the smooth incidence lies between those two curves. Now, the predictions for the main analysis, so assuming that it takes 9 years to go from S4 to S1, to wane immunity, so totally in nine years. You have here in the y-axis incidence severe cases, so I4 infection. You have represented by the vertical red line the limits between past and prediction, and by the dashed black line, the start of the relaxation of barrier gestures. In the different colors, you have the different magnitude of relaxation of barrier gestures, and in peak, we have the relaxation with the k-value elevated to 1, which means a full relaxation of barrier gestures. You can see that whatever the start of the relaxation, if there is a full relaxation of barrier gestures, we have a peak of incident severe cases that exceed what have been observed in the past, the second and the third waves for France. If we look differently to the results, but these figures mean the same thing and represent the same thing, it's just focusing on prevalent ICU hospitalization. You have the different months of barrier gesture relaxation, and the dot represents the peak of prevalent ICU hospitalization following each relaxation scenario. You have the different colors representing the different magnitude of k-value elevation. So this is the main analysis. So it's the same result that I showed you just before. Now let's focus on the impact of immunity duration hypothesis. On the top right, you have the same results assuming that immunity went totally in 3 years. In that case, our predictions tend to be higher and on average 86% higher, so very pessimistic, but it's with this assumption of 3 years waning immunity. So it has a significant impact on our prediction. On the other hand, if we assume that immunity does not wane, it has also a great impact, and our predictions are on average 46% lower. If we focus on the impact of vaccine hesitancy, because it's an important subject for France, on the left, you have the main analysis. So with vaccine hesitancy and the proportion I showed you in the method. If we assume that there is no vaccine hesitancy, which means that 100% of the eligible population is vaccinated at the end of October, you can see that here, it would be, tell you that the blue line, the horizontal blue line, corresponds to the limit of ICU beds capacity for France. Sorry. So it's important. And you can see here that from November and December, if we assume that there is no vaccine hesitancy, it would be possible, according to our predictions, to fully relax barrier gestures, which correspond to the yellow dots, without overwhelming ICU bed capacity in France. Whereas if we assume a 10% vaccine hesitancy, which is a lower percentage of vaccine hesitancy compared to the main analysis, our predictions are lower, but from November and December, it would not be possible to relax fully barrier gesture without overwhelming ICU bed capacity. So to conclude in this first and major part, this work we show that barrier gestures still play a crucial role in maintaining epidemic control in France, in particular in the context of vaccine hesitancy. And we also highlighted that immunity duration assumptions influence significantly the short-term dynamic of the epidemic. One limit, and it will be possible to discuss after about that, issue is the proportion fit assumptions. We don't know to which proportion of infections we should calibrate our model to incidence COVID-19 cases. Also, the K-value is the only parameter that is fit to data and may reflect other things than only barrier gestures. And in particular, one main thing that we didn't take into account is climate, impact of climate on transmission. So now let's just move on the second part, but there is few slides. Our question was to try to estimate what should be the good proportion fits to incidence cases. To do that, we use seroprevalence estimations that we have for France from other work from French team. And they have estimated that about 6% of the populations have been infected in May 2020 and about 15% in February 2021. We ask, does our model get similar estimations? So using the same model I presented before, but just assuming that immunity went totally in 3 years, whereas it went totally in 9 years, because for now, it seems that it would be maybe more realistic to assume that immunity totally wane in 3 years. And assuming that, you can see here the seroprevalence we obtained from the model. So let me explain this plot. You have represented it in red, the proportion of the population that have some natural immunity. So people that are in S2, S3 and S4 compartments, so in red. And the different shades of red correspond to the different age classes. You have in blue people in V1 compartments and in green people in V2 compartments. And let's focus on period before vaccination implementation. If we compare our seroprevalence estimation to what have been estimated by other works, we can see here that we tend to overestimate seroprevalence if we compare to what have been estimated, we tend to overestimate. So we try to change a little bit how we fit the data, and we choose to fit the model to hospitalization data, assuming that hospitalization data correspond to half of severe infections I4. In that case, you have here on the left, the K-value estimated. You can see that the calibration period is a little bit wider because we calibrate until the 1st September 2021. And you have on the right the calibration plot with incidence, smooth incidence hospitalization data in red. When we fit to hospitalization data, our results, our seroprevalence estimation is this plot. And you can see that we get a little bit closer to what have been estimated. So it was, I remind to you, it was 6% in May and 15% in February. So it's a little bit closer. So the second thing we try to do is to try to estimate which proportion of infections would be good, would be the good proportion to fit to incidence to reported COVID-19 cases. So we plot our calibration plot I just presented before. So this calibration plot corresponds to the fit to hospitalization. So here we fit half of IFOR to hospitalization data. You have in red hospitalization data, and I just add incidence data in purple to see where this line lies between our infections from the model. And you can see that if we look to this plot, we would deduce that to fit an incidence data, we should fit to all I4, all I3, and a certain proportion of I2. So we tried that, and we fit to either 10% of I2 plus all I3, all I4, or 20% of I2 plus I3 plus I4, and we looked to the seroprevalence estimations we get. And you can see that when we choose this proportion fit to incident COVID-19 cases, we get closer to seroprevalence estimation we have for France. So I am done. It was everything I wanted to show you today, and maybe we can discuss these results. And if you have questions, you can tell me and ask me.
Thank you. Thanks, Carol. There are a couple of questions in the chat, and I'll read the first one. Is the waning immunity assumption the same rate for every age group?
Yes. Yes, it is the same rate, but it would be maybe interesting to stratify the rate by age, because maybe the elderly may wane a little bit faster, and maybe that's what the literature shows. So yes, it would be interesting to stratify by age. It's possible. It is possible with the model and the code.
Yeah, thank you. And have you considered seasonality in the infection rate?
No, we haven't. And it would be interesting because we have some papers that show us that seasonality have an impact on transmission, and it would be interesting to implement it, but it's further work.
Okay, but do you think that the K value might be able to capture that? Yes. A little bit?
The K value captures that, I think so, but.
We have one more question. What are the implications of the finding that the proportion of 20% I2 plus I3 plus I4 fit the data best?
What are the implications?
So you're gonna go back and redo the previous analysis?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ah, yes, the implication. Yes, well, it would be interesting to redo the previous analysis with this proportion fit, I agree. And implications, what would it be? So we increase the proportion fit. Yes, I think our waves would be even higher because we assume that our proportion fit is a little bit low compared to here. So the immunity that I think our wave would be higher. I don't know, what do you think, Jane? But if we redo the analysis, I think the waves would be higher when we relax barrier gestures, because our seroprevalence, yes, it was where we were saying before, our seroprevalence are overestimated in our previous work. So yes.
Yeah, so the new waves are probably, well, there's two things. You have the new prevalence to fit to the new incidence data, but also you changed your waning rate. So it's hard to say what the outcome
yes.
will be.
I changed the waning rate, but when I changing the waning rate also increase the wave. So the two changements go in the same direction. So.
Okay. Well, thank you, Carol, very much. If people have more questions, there will be time in the discussion panel.